people are Maroons, descendants of those that took to the hills because they refused to live as slaves under the British. They led the resistance to slavery and defeated the British in many battles. Remarkably, the Maroons' most famous leader was a woman known simply by the name of Nanny. She was a general, a teacher, and a spiritual healer. Few actual details of her life are known, but despite the mystery that surrounds her, she's Jamaica's only female national hero, and I'm here to find out why.
This one's for my sisters. This comes from the heart, from the little girls in the park to baby mamas working hard, misunderstood queens working after dark, those exposing their titties and all to their records chart.
I come from a home where whatever time of day or night, music was playing in my household 24/7 constantly. So yeah, I would say I come from a musical background.
I don't give a damn what they say. Misunderstood, misguided, misled, mislead.
My family background is very, very mixed. Basically, between my mum, my dad and my grandparents, we've got Scottish, English, Irish, Jamaican, Bayesian, German. What else? Grenadian, kind of a bit of everything. I'm just a mixture.
I first heard about Nanny at the Winnie Mandela School near where I grew up in North London. I was always fascinated by the stories about my family's Jamaican past, especially those about the years of slavery. But the story that really got to me was the one about Nanny of the Maroons. She's a legendary figure in the same style as Robin Hood or King Arthur, a black woman who nearly 300 years ago led the Maroons, Jamaica's fiercest freedom fighters, to victory over the British. Her campaigns helped pave the way toward the ending of slavery in the New World.
Today, we are going to be talking about a very important lady in Jamaican history. Her name was Nanny. And she's called Nanny of the Maroons because she was a member of a community in Jamaica called the Maroon community.
Like these kids, everything about Nanny thrilled me. Her strength, her rebelliousness, the fact that she was a woman leading men. She was the queen of resistance fighters, but her story didn't fit in with the neat histories of the British queens I'd heard about. I was mystified by the gaps in the story. Like, where was she from?
Ghana.
Moortown, Jamaica, Portland.
Probably Ashanti.
Up in the Windward, Rio Grande Valley.
Danny, when was she born?
I'm not sure of the actual date.
Beginning of the 1700s.
Maybe 1680s, 16 something or 1690s.
How did she get to Jamaica?
On a slave ship.
Slave ship?
It was aboard a slave ship.
She had the power to make herself invisible, so they were not aware of her presence.
When did she die?
Some people say she flew away on her cabbage skin.
I think it was the 1780s.
Sometimes after 1779.
I am not sure.
Probably no later than the early 1750s.
We might never know the truth.
And if the truth is there's no truth about Nanny, how did she become such a massive Jamaican national icon?
Don't call me Scarface.
I first came to Jamaica as a 10-year-old and quickly grew to love it here. 2007 marks the 200th anniversary of the Parliamentary Act to end the British slave trade. But whereas at home people see it as history, Here is very much a current issue.
Historian Dr. Vereen Shepherd says she is not surprised that British Prime Minister Tony Blair expressed sorrow over his country's role in the slave trade, but did not apologize for...
The first time you're in Jamaica?
No, I've been here quite a few times.
Okay.
Quite a few times.
So what's the visit this time?
We've come to shoot a documentary about the Nanny of the Maroons.
Oh, bless your heart. Yeah.
Why do you say that?
She's a gem. She's a gem in my book.
Oh, you like her?
And I love her.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah.
Do you know a lot about her?
Well, she was the organizer, firstly. She was the mother of the struggle.
Hmm?
She was the lady that, you know, men only have big mouth, you know. But when it comes to the toothache and the stress, it's the women who has to do the, like the women who organize the parental side of the family.
Mm-hmm.
She is like that. I've made a song about her. The kind of war that was fought with Nanny and them is a terrible war, a guerrilla war, you know.
Yeah.
And the poor little British from England come with him, look at touch gun and look at touch thing. And there's some big stone with him.
Yeah.
Them not understand that. Them have to give up. So thanks to she, you know, we can there Jamaica live free.
Would you mind singing your song for me that you said you wrote about Nanny?
I won't do it. Nanny, Nanny, you're the best. What you did was better than the rest. And at the time you couldn't even buy your dress. Now I salute you for the things that you do. Your respect and honor is more than overdue. For the pain you've been through, the hurt and the suffering too. God bless you, and I love you. God bless you, Nanny.
That's really beautiful.
Thanks.
Really beautiful. That's nice.
I'm
sure she loved that. Thank you. Thank you. Thanks a lot. How much is that?
$1,500.
Okay.
Bless it. I hear me. And Nanny this, you know. Nanny.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. Bless.
All right. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Care.
Chains. Chains. Chains separate the people from them African spirit, and every mile of misery in the belly of the ship take them further from spirit. Passage them to this new land, spirit dimmed by distance and oceans. And then comes Nanny. Unchained spirit are born in our belly. Come to relight the spirit fires. Come to make with free spirits again. 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 Again.
irieFM. Thought provoking. Always smoking. Lyrics like a bazooka. You are listening to Mutabaruka.
Yeah, greetings. This is Cutting Edge. I say give thanks being here. We have a special guest tonight on Cutting Edge. All the way from England.
I'm just Miss Dynamite.
Sister Dynamite. Good night. How are you doing?
I'm fine, thank you. How are you?
I'm okay.
Yes.
What are you doing in Jamaica?
I've come here basically to find out as much information as I possibly can about Nanny of the Maroons.
Nanny, out of all of the Maroons, as a female, she has been one of the greatest resistors to British colonialism in Jamaica. So it's really good that, as a young person too, that you should find it interesting to really deal with.
I think that's the main thing that attracts me to her, the fact that she's so rebellious.
Yes.
And she's so kind of, it's my way or no way. I like that.
You know, them said Nanny used to catch bullet in her bottom.
Okay.
Maybe them cut that off for the program. That is one of the the mythologies that them have to build up Nanny as a great person. So a lot of people in Jamaica, because of the mythologies, they start to believe that she really didn't exist.
Okay.
You see, and that is really a travesty. Because when you start to, when you have an icon or a person who is a liberator, and then you start to develop mythologies around him, people who feel that they're sensible and intelligent, they question the mythologies. And in questioning the mythologies now, they claim that if the mythology is not true, therefore the person is also not true.
I'm just Miss Dynamite.
I think when I'm here, I know I'm English, but there's something where, I guess it's just this, just black people full stop, but there's something where I can definitely relate, I can understand in terms of culture, in terms of, that's probably the side of me that since I was born, that's the side I've kind of leaned more towards.
Muta had got me thinking. It's all too easy to dismiss Nanny's story simply as a myth. But there's nothing mythical about the people she led, the Maroons, and they would be my starting point on my journey of understanding. I'd learned something about Nanny's Maroons as a kid. They were part of the resistance to slavery that sprung up all over the New World. Maroons in Jamaica date back to 1655, when Britain invaded the then Spanish island. The Africans who fought alongside the Spanish took off to the hills rather than face enslavement. The Maroons were born, and they soon became a magnet for runaway slaves. The Maroons are key to understanding the importance of Nanny. Today, they still live in their own semi-autonomous areas, one from the British. They have their own leaders or colonels. I went to meet Colonel Frank Lumsden. What, I wondered, does the term Maroon actually mean?
The Africans, because of their knowledge of herding cattle in Africa, were the cattle herders for the Spanish. And they had to chase some of the wild cattle into the bush. And the wild cattle are called Cimarron, hence the name Maroon, meaning wild and untamed, which is why we have the skull of the cows here.
Can you tell me, what does being a Maroon mean to you?
After 8 or 5 years of armed conflict, a group of Africans made the greatest empire on earth, signed for the first time in its history, a peace treaty. This, as far as I'm concerned, remains Jamaica's greatest achievement, and is something to be preserved, and being Maroon is of vital importance, because freedom is why I live the way I live.
Are ancestors something that are really important to Maroon culture and community?
There is something magical about Maroon culture. The Maroons don't see death as something that separates them from their ancestors. They're very much present.
Frank also told me that the Akompong Festival is the place to go to understand Maroon culture. This is the home of the Leeward Maroons, one of the two main Maroon groups in Jamaica who occupied the west of the island, while Nanny's Windward Maroons were based in the east. The festival is an annual celebration of the signing of the 1738 treaty, by which the British accepted defeat at the hands of the Leeward Maroons and granted them their own territory. It's also a celebration of Maroon culture and heritage. This man's playing the abeng, an instrument which has its roots in Africa. It's made from a bull's horn and played a vital part in the war with the British as a means of communication for Maroon warriors. As Frank said, the ancestors are all important to the Maroons. This procession is going down to the old town to offer food to them. Only Maroons can take part. I wanted to know what made the Maroons so special.
A Maroon is special because we were the first set of free people. I would consider myself first as a Maroon and then as a Jamaican because we are very special. And another thing about is that the Maroons, we don't pay land taxes. We live free here.
Okay.
Yes, we are free people.
Okay.
Yes.
How can you tell? Is there a way to tell a Maroon from an ordinary Jamaican or black person?
Okay, they said the Maroons, they have like red eyes. They are short people. Some of them are thick. And they even have special marks underneath the soles of their feet.
Okay.
Yes, so an elder Maroon could look underneath your foot bottom or even the palm of your hands and tell if you're a Maroon.
Okay. Is it marks that have been put there or marks that are naturally there?
No, like underneath the sole of the feet, we have some special brown marks that are designed in some way that they can look on and determine what it is.
Okay.
Yes, and with the palm is naturally always brown like mine. You can look at yours, it's actually white.
Okay.
So mine is brown.
A kompong is a meeting point for the two main groups of Maroons in Jamaica, from the east and west of the island. Although Nanny was not the leader here, there's a huge shared pride in being a Maroon. This is a celebration of a warrior tradition. The bush headdress is a tribute to what Maroons call ambush, a form of camouflage used to great effect by Nanny in the war with the British. I went off to find out more about it.
Hi, Mark.
Good morning.
How are you?
I'm fine.
You all right?
Yeah.
I've been told that you're going to show me the technique of camouflage.
Yeah, that's what I'm doing right now.
Because
camouflage is an instance that our ancestors used to use during the war days between the Maroons and the British when they were fighting in the mountains.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm told that it's a technique that Nanny actually invented.
That's why I say my ancestors.
Okay.
So when I mention of ancestors, I mean Nanny, cousin, all of them who fought the war between the Maroons and the British.
Okay. Yeah. Is there a specific type of leaf or bush that is better to use than another?
Yes, some of them may scratch you. Some cannot tie on a lot like others do.
And is there a specific way to put it on?
Yeah, because you don't want to see the one in the camouflage face nor anything. You want to see it look like a plant standing. Well, I said so.
And how does it feel for you to be in there? Does it feel comfortable?
Me?
Yeah.
Would the Maroons, like in the camouflage, usually be armed with something?
Every time they attack a British soldier, they would get their weapons from them. But they used to use mainly sticks and things before they have any weapons. So we're gonna walk out now so you can see it in the open.
Okay.
Yeah. We are in the mountains now, so we are going through the mountain. There's no home, nothing there. So it looks like a wild.
Okay.
No one is living there.
Mm-hmm.
So when you go through, when someone in camouflage, when you bounce up on him like that, because we weren't looking for any persons living in there. So we'd have to do like this, we'd be frightened first.
Definitely.
Because we weren't looking for someone living here.
I like the fact that the Maroons have totally kept themselves to themselves and just basically they live in their way under their terms. I like that because it's kind of like the sense of rebellion, the sense of we're gonna do what we want to do and live how we want to live, which is how they began. It's still very much a part of their culture, their society today.
I wanted to find out about Nanny the general. Between 1730 and 1740, Jamaica was shaken to the core by a bloody and terrifying rebellion. This wasn't just a local uprising, but an armed insurrection against an international superpower. What's amazing is that far from crushing the uprising, the British were driven to the brink of total military defeat. The world's greatest military force suffered thousands of casualties. The Maroons? Barely a handful. It was one of the greatest upsets in the history of the British Empire. The Maroons' use of the terrain was key to their success.
The last battle that was fought in the First Maroon Wars was at the Spanish River. And I will show you how the youth of it played a significant part. The Maroons used psychology in their warfare. What they tried to do, what they did, is to drive fear to the point of dread into their enemies. They would actually let some people go through so that they could report the dread. Mm-hmm. And their bang. Their bang was also used, an important part of that, because the sound of their bang at that time is not only loud, but it also chills the blood. That reverberating sound.
Very.
And here, as the British were coming through, the Maroons had scouts on either side on such a narrow pathway. They let the scouts and point people through the trap as they came out, and then they fell in on the main body, slicing them up as they came through.
Okay.
The British broke and ran for a cover, much like that, fighting from beyond that cover. The Maroons then crossed the river and attacked them from that side, their exposed flank. And here they decimated the British. And it was after this battle that the victory was so complete that the British felt it was time to sue for peace.
Nanny warrior, follow the river upstream to the hills to give birth to a nation of Maroon rebels. Fighters cocooned in cocoon vines, green and invisible to European eyes, till the swift machete, the sudden stream of blood, the quick fade into hill and gully, to celebrate with Nanny down by the riverside, round the fireless, bubbling Obia herb pot.
For the British Army, the Jamaican campaign must have been a miserable affair. Plagued by malaria and yellow fever, they found themselves facing one of the earliest guerrilla campaigns known to military historians. In Nanny, they were up against a formidable general, a Jamaican Boudica who combined military and spiritual powers. She moulded a disparate group of rebels into an army that struck fear into British hearts.
In any war, you can't fight an enemy that you can't see. One soldier was saying he saw a tree trembling in the distance. The next minute, it was a Maroon right beside him with a machete at his neck.
Is it possible that the Maroon casualties were so low whilst the British casualties were so high?
It's easy to look now and think of the British forces and say, no, it shouldn't be like that. But they were dealing with tactics that they were very, very new to. It was extremely novel to them. They could not react. They did not have a mechanism in place to deal with these type of attacks. These Maroons, they practice every day. It became their culture.
Yeah.
By definition, that's what Maroons are. They're warriors.
How important were Nanny's obia or spiritual powers for the Maroon campaign at the time?
I would say that for the guerrilla campaign for the Maroons, Nanny's prowess as an obia woman was the most important. It instilled fear in the British forces. She was reported as having around her her waist knives. For each knife, and there were about 80, had killed a British soldier. And she wore around her neck the teeth of some of the British soldiers that she'd killed. So that fear of witchcraft, that fear of necromancy, was the Maroons' greatest weapon. It made the British soldiers ineffective, unable to think, confused, and basically easier to defeat.
And this is the all-important crop the British were fighting to defend. Sugar. Today it plays a minor part in Jamaican culture, but in Nanny's day, sugar was the oil of its time. It wasn't just the need to sabotage the British that motivated Nanny and her Maroons. It was the imperative to combat the evil behind sugar production. Enslavement. Nanny really was more than just a rebel. She was a freedom fighter.
I think slavery had everything to do with racism. The excuse since slavery, or the excuses have been, well, you know, we didn't know they were human, real human, the same as us. We didn't know that they were educated. We didn't know that. To me, they're all forms of racism. The slavery that we faced was the only type of slavery where they did everything in their power to basically disattach us from our identity, from you know, knowing who we are, what we are, etc., etc. No one else has faced a slavery like that.
I met up with historian Cecil Gutsmore, who told me about the madness of the system of slavery that Nanny was up against.
Well, there's a level at which the punishment makes you almost think that the slave masters as a breed were crazy.
Mm-hmm.
They put enslaved people into the ground, put ants on them, they tied them onto cannons and blew them up. People who ran away had limbs cut off.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, we have various other items here. This, for example, is leg irons. And what would have happened is that the spike would have been driven into the ground, and a person who would run away, mm-hmm, or offended against the system in some way would be chained to that and left out in the boiling sun, or okay, had bees or ants or whatever added
to them. These look really small in comparison.
Yes, the point has been made that conceivably this was meant for a child.
What is this here?
Well, this is a gibbet or gibbet. It was found here in Jamaica in during the 19th century, and that when found, it still had human remains in it, that is to say bones, a skeleton of a person. An individual offending African, somebody who rebelled in some way, somebody who ran away, who didn't come to order, would have been put into that and hung and might have been left to rot. In the sun. But you have to remember, the slave population greatly outnumbered the controlling forces, the whites, and so essential to the system was the notion that those who were its victims knew the consequences of stepping out of line.
Seeing the stuff that Cecil showed me was the hardest thing I think that I've experienced or seen or known about slavery. Until you're actually standing there in front of shackles that are used for a child, I don't know, it just made it much more real to me, and I couldn't help but picture children, you know, my own son or, you know, children that I know in that type of a position. And it was really, really, really heartbreaking. Like, it's taken me a long time to stop thinking about it and get it out of my mind. It's just, you can't begin to even slightly imagine the type of mind that could invent such, like, contract, like, it was just unbelievable, to be honest.
The plantation houses built on the back of slavery still dot the Jamaican landscape with their strange beauty. I wanted to know how deep the memory of enslavement, with all its brutality, still runs. Especially among those whose ancestors profited from it. David and Nikki Farquharson own a nearby sugar plantation which has been in their family for hundreds of years.
Can you tell me, were you told about the brutality of slavery as a child?
No, I went to school in the UK at 7. So, you know, most of what I've learned, the history of Jamaica, has been in the UK.
Okay.
And then coming back here. I came back in 1990. And basically read, okay. Listen.
But what about in terms of the actual brutality that took place? I understand, like, in terms of slavery in general, but actually, specifically, the brutality that took place.
You mean what sort of things went on?
No. Not what went on, but is that something that you've actually learned about?
Yeah, certainly. I think it's pretty well documented. I think people know. I mean, it was a. You've got a system where a small number of people are controlling and keeping in subjugation a large number of people, forcing them to work. The rules that basically a slave owner could do practically anything.
Who do you think was responsible for the brutality that took place?
Who was responsible?
Yeah.
You mean who actually carried it out?
Yeah. Who was responsible for?
Or the slave owners, the state, the judges. But it was a societal thing here. It's a set up society.
As a descendant of people who profited from the brutality of slavery, and as somebody that still reaps the benefits today, how do you feel about that?
That's a very loaded question. Everyone benefits, or is there are good things and bad things about anyone's existence. I'm the product of my parents and their families and a society, as you are.
Mm-hmm.
Do I feel guilty about my involvement in slavery or my benefit in slavery? No.
if I was somebody that woke up every day in a beautiful house and was born into wealth and lived in, you know, the middle of paradise, and I knew that the only reason that I was able to live that type of a life was because my ancestors had tortured, raped, stole, you know, a set of people, I personally couldn't live comfortably with knowing that, you know, those factors. Especially if I wasn't doing something to sort of make amends of what had taken place.
Are you? Yeah, I try to live my life. Well, it's a very peculiar thing. I don't carry a cross, no. So I don't feel as though I should be going out, and I'm not making atonement for anything. I'm trying to live my life as a Jamaican, life in 1700s was a bit more brutal generally everywhere than it is now.
Obviously, the way of life then and the way of life now, there's a lot of differences, but as far as I'm concerned, mm-hmm. or I can see, you know, when I read or see, you know, pictures, or actually mm-hmm. see, you know, the shackles that people yeah. were held in, and the things that they were used to punish them, like human cages that they were hung in, etc., etc., or reading stories about the fact that they were boiled in baths of boiling sugar, yeah. or had their legs tied from two trees, and, you know, the trees let go and ripped apart. To yeah. me, that's not something that affects me, because I've got such high morals. You know, whether that happened at the beginning of time or at the end of time, right. to me, that's something that...
So why does it affect you?
What do you mean?
Well, you say it doesn't affect you. It isn't affecting you because you've got higher moral values.
All right, it's not
values.
Something... It's
how does it... It affects
yeah,
you,
it
I
Yeah, it definitely
take.
Affects okay. me, because why? I know that it's something that happened to part of my ancestors at the end of the day. That's not something I can just, you know, okay. feel comfortable about.
The evil of slavery, mm-hmm. to my mind, mm-hmm. is an economic system which basically exploited mm-hmm. not one individual within the same group. It's the whole, I suppose, the theological, the societal idea of let's exploit another group. Mm-hmm. And that's one of the problems that within this society you can define, or you can choose to define goodness or badness mm-hmm. based upon the color of your skin.
I don't personally think that we should go around and make people, you know, individual people responsible for what their ancestors did, but I think a little acknowledgement would be nice. And I do feel that David acknowledged what had taken place, but it did trouble me to know that he, how can I explain it, that he didn't seem even slightly fazed. Like, if that was me, I wouldn't be comfortable living knowing that the only reason I'm waking up every morning in a beautiful house in the middle of paradise is because my ancestors raped, killed, tortured, and really brutally murdered adults and children.
Nanny knew the best way to hurt the British was to hit them in their pocket. She attacked the plantations, making it impossible for the sugar to be collected, and profits plummeted. In 1734, 27 plantations had to be abandoned. The cost to the empire was huge, and the empire struck back in the only way it knew, by demonizing her as an old hag, and worse, as a witch. Of course, only witchcraft could explain her success.
And in the civilized British mind, the questions burn. How this simple savage, this less than human, this woman, can so long defy the might of empire. And though them laugh on the veranda, swap stories about our big bottom, our superstition, our obia. There's a fear behind the banter, cause out there in the bush, there still lurks the enigma. That is Nanny. That is Nanny.
Moortown is the home of Nanny's Wynwood Maroons. Here, she's regarded as much a teacher and spiritual leader as a warrior. Whilst Obia was slandered as black magic, many of its practitioners were herbal healers, and Nanny was said to have great wisdom and knowledge of the herbs that surrounded her here. Just outside Moortown lives a herbalist who claims to be Nanny's direct descendant and who explains the skills they share not as magic, but science.
Science is the state of people's mind. Science is the plants around you. Mm-hmm. Science is the earth. Science mm-hmm. is the sun. Science is indigenous world.
Do you think that people that tarnish or have tarnished Nanny with the kind of negative side or as being an Obia woman is because she did things and kind of performed miracles or whatever that they just couldn't understand?
Yeah, okay. Yeah, exactly. She performed different miracles with herbs. Because I can tell you this, I knew a man, right, for 14 years he never walked straight. Mm-hmm. He never walked straight. And the man came here, right, and I gave the man one herbal bath. And the taxi guy who brought the man here came back for the man, passed the man, and didn't knew it was the man. Mm-hmm. Because he stood up straight for the first time in 14 years. Wow. Think about that. So you have to just know the type of things to use.
So what about her deflecting bullets?
Well, that was a lie. That was a myth. She made a scarecrow and put it on Watch Hill.
Okay.
Because she was very tactical, you know, she made a scarecrow and put it on Watch Hill. So that scarecrow would stoop, you know, like that. But then, you know, the feet is made of sticks. So it would stay like that. So every time the bullet goes through, like, through the skirts. So they would think it was she up there catching bullet with her bottom. That's ridiculous.
Said it was 96 degrees in the shade. 10,000 soldiers on parade.
Today, most Maroons in Moortown are farmers, often banana growers working small plantations in the surrounding countryside and sending their produce to Britain. The colonel here is Wallace Sterling. He told me something very surprising about the roots of the Maroons.
Don't for one moment think that the slave trade in Africa started by the Europeans. It wasn't. The Arabs were there and pretty much involved in that. It is obvious that some of our foreparents had Islamic teaching before they came to this part of the world. One of the ways that we greet people around here, a Maroon will greet another Maroon, is to say, Salam Alaikum. This is a typical Arab way of greeting people.
When I was in Akompong at the festival, I noticed that there was a lot of rum used within the ceremony.
In the ceremonies where you are communicating with the spirit of your ancestors, you need to appease them and pouring a libation, communicating with them, talking to them. Rum is what is used to pour the libation.
Mati, property. No, for fucking, no, came picking, uncle, just, you know, alas. It
Nikki Bobby come and put a full year in me. Unti! Mandimanti property.
In the evening, life circulates around the shop comboire, where there's always a game of dominoes to be had. And the night time is the right time to catch janga, the crayfish that populate the local river. It's a tradition that goes back hundreds of years.
Jamaica and Roma.
Security was vital for Nanny's Maroons. It even affected the way they cooked. Jerk pork is now practically a national dish, and it was invented by the Maroons.
Get your feet moving now. Time to start moving now. It's been a long, 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 long time.
In Nanny's time, the pork was cooked in a pit dug in the earth, then covered with bushes so that the smoke from the fire couldn't give the Maroon positions away. The smoked pork could then be packed and eaten on the run by the Maroon warriors. Today is best enjoyed with a bowl of janga soup.
Despite there being few actual facts about Nanny's life, or death for that matter, there is concrete evidence that proves that this mystical figure of resistance did actually exist. Spanish Town is the old capital, which the British replaced with Kingston. Today, it's home to the National Archive, where Cecil Gutsmore showed me an official document which names Nanny.
I think this is some of the clearest evidence that we have of her actual existence. She's named in this particular document. The land is a grant of land to her. And it's clear, therefore, that she existed.
Was this land a gift from them, or I mean, was it land that already belonged to her?
Well, if you ask that question in that way, I would have to say that it was an acknowledgement of a state of a pre-existing state of affairs. Okay. The Maroons were in occupation of vast tracts of the interior of the country. Mm-hmm. By virtue of the fight they put up, they had effectively excluded plantation occupation and other forms of occupation from those parts of the island. So they felt that that was their land to start with. The British, of course, had a different view.
But Cecil also had something more disturbing to show me. This is the 1738 treaty which the Leeward Maroons signed with the British, and which I'd seen celebrated at a compong. But to Cecil, this treaty, which acknowledged Maroon success, also made them collaborators with the slave owners.
The treaty required them to do two worrying, in my terms, things. And the first of those was that they were required to return runaways. And the Akompong Treaty required the Maroons to send back everybody who had come into their community within the period of 2 years prior to the treaty actually being signed. And they did that.
How did Nanny regard this treaty?
There is good evidence that Nanny was opposed the treaty. The band or community was divided between those who wished to lay down their arms and those who wished to continue the fight. The Windward Maroons did not as willingly accept the treaty as did the other band. So her name is not on the treaty.
Is there not evidence that at that particular time they had no choice because they were starving and etc.?
I don't know that there's evidence of starvation, and I think that the truth of the matter is that you always have a choice.
Even though he'd cleared Nanny, I was very reluctant to accept Cecil's view that the Maroons had been collaborators. Surely there must have been extenuating circumstances that drove them to it. However, writer and academic Carolyn Cooper, herself a Maroon, has a different view.
To some degree, the Maroons were collaborators with the British. They had fought for their independence. They signed a treaty that gave them power. And part of the treaty was to say, you know, nobody else is going to come and join you guys, and we've settled with you people, the others must stay on the plantation. And I think the Maroons made a strategic decision to protect their own interests.
Where would you say the spirit of the Maroons lies in modern Jamaican culture today?
The spirit of the Maroons is everywhere in Jamaica. I tell you, the way people drive on the road is a sign of this rebellion against law and order. And sometimes people don't recognize that the law and order that they're rebelling against is what is in place to make things good for us. Because we're so accustomed to this notion that the system is against us and we have to turn Maroons and run away, that we're working sometimes against ourselves. But from a positive perspective, I think the spirit of Maroonage is evident in the everyday struggles of people to survive. Buju Banton has a brilliant line, his celebration of the Higglers. A struggle she that struggle for achieve little something, and a try she that try. She's struggling to achieve something and she's trying hard. And it's that spirit of struggle, of resistance, of not giving in to negative social forces. That is the spirit of the Maroons, alive and well in Jamaica today.
Days of slavery. Do you remember the days of slavery?
It's widely accepted that Nanny did not collaborate with the British, and perhaps because of this, her reputation has thrived since Jamaica became independent in 1962.
In 1976, Nanny was named Jamaica's first and only female national hero. This sculpture represents her. It shows her warriors and her abeng. The image of Nanny is something that's always been an issue. This has always been the accepted picture of her. However, an artist has come along that challenges this view.
Renee Cox is the African-American Cindy Sherman. In her latest project, she's taken on the persona of Nanny.
I first heard about Nanny as a child.
Okay.
And then I'd say later on, probably about 5-6 years ago, I started doing research on her and finding out more information about who she was.
Mm-hmm.
Based on what we know, I mean, she was an incredible woman, mm-hmm, with an incredible spirit, mm-hmm, and somebody that was not going to be defeated.
Mm-hmm.
She was empowered,
mm-hmm,
and that's what I'm interested in with my work in terms of representations of women. Well, this is Nanny in a red coat. And once you defeat a certain, you know, group of people, whatever,
mm-hmm,
and then you decide to don their uniform, mm-hmm, it's sort of like a bit of a slap in the face,
yeah,
if you want.
Mm-hmm.
So that's basically what she's doing here. And then the important thing for me is a lot of times when we see images of African-Americans or Afro-Caribbeans or, you know, Africans in England and diaspora, we kind of lose the gaze. We're never given a gaze, you know, direct eye contact. And for me, another thing that's important is to be able to bring that gaze out to the audience. You know what I'm saying? That it's like, I command, I rule this space. I decide what happens here. It's about feeling strong in one's skin and being proud of one's culture.
That really comes across.
And then also the use of scale. You know, another thing that I always say, it's like a lot of times when you go into, like, you know, black folks' homes, family pictures are like this big and they're like broken up in some crunched up frame. And I'm like, that's not good for your head. You know what I'm saying? Like, you go into some European's house and they've got some giant, you know, oil painting of one of their ancestors standing there with a rifle and a pheasant and everything, you know, looking all powerful and part of the whole feudal system. So I'm like, if you're growing up, you're like, well,
messages that essence.
I'm entitled. It's about entitlement.
Definitely.
So who decides that?
I felt I'd learnt a lot about Nanny. Not only why she's such a Jamaican icon, a queenly figure so important to the nation's history, but why she means so much to me as a black woman.
I think for me, the fact that Nanny was African was probably the most important thing, because somewhere along the line, through the generations, as black people, we seem to have forgotten that we are African, or that at least that our ancestors were directly African. And it's not always looked upon as something to be proud of or to go and tell people about. And for me, I just found it really, I don't know, inspiring, and kind of even more so empowering that she was an African woman. She stands for, you know, confidence, struggle, resistance, rebellion, you know, not bowing down to somebody's expectations of her. But I definitely think that there's been times in the last week where I've learned little things about Nanny here or there, and I think, oh my gosh, that's such a me thing to do, or a me thing to say, or a way that I personally think I would be. Like, there is a little rebel in me.
And I notice you haven't changed drivers. You kept your... little barrel with you. I mean, not your little barrel, but gotta watch the size now.
Oh gosh.
Having the plans coming back shortly?
Yeah, I'd love to come back again. I don't think this trip hasn't been long enough for me. So definitely I'll be back soon.
Alive. Nanny, you know, my grandmother. You know, my daughter and mother. And do them not get no honor. Not even after them dead. Is them silent, invisible strength. Is them raging, bun belly ball. That save with time and time.